I'm Tal Ron, and we'll speak now on Vanuatu, offshore licenses, and the new regulatory and banking regime. If I'm too fast, let me, and I will speak slowly, okay? Great. Tal Ron, so I'm the CEO and chairman of Tal Ron Dryman Co. We're an international law firm. We do only legal stuff that interests us. So if you're looking for ambulance chasing and torts law and criminal law, I don't deal with this kind of stuff. We do only financial law, gaming law. We do some adult entertainment, and that's the whitewashed name for adult entertainment. Hope you know what's this. But this sector, it's like the blockchain. Not many lawyers want to get into this industry, so I took the spot and I really enjoy doing this dating law and all this kind of interesting blockchain gaming, forex, CFD. Wherever there is interest, we're there, and that's us. And for us, it'll be very interesting now to speak about a thing that is actually very, very hot at the moment. Because I believe that many people know that lots of brokers and financial services providers that are based in Australia have a very interesting shift nowadays. So let's start and understand what's going on. So ASIC, this regulation, this financial regulation in Australia, which is not very far from here, you know, if I was living in Australia and some of my friends here came also from Sydney, I told you yesterday that if I was living in Australia, I would be coming every week. We have here guys for Olive Financial Services from Australia, also a very well-known brand and reputed brand, and I would come here all the time. So there is a connection between Australia and Asia, and I believe many of the old people know that. Australia and ASIC is no longer a safe haven for brokerages. I can tell you from Tel Aviv, I'm from Tel Aviv, many people looked at Australia as a very good place to regulate if you want to do a nice brokerage and accept clients from all around the world in Southeast Asia and make it profitable. ASIC is no longer a safe haven for brokerages. And now we have lots of information that the regulators ask. And they want you to give a detailed breakdown of client numbers, account size, income, number of clients transferred overseas. And you need to have the snapshot for December 2017 and March 2008. It's very, very detailed. In the past, we didn't have to supply all this information. Now, there's also this allocation of A book and B book. Okay, B book is all those guys who like to gamble, like to play, like to be very aggressive. A book is like more conservative STP processing. Now you need to give numbers. You need to explain the criteria, the qualification, and it goes until you need to give who's the liquidity, who's the platform. Let's say I'm working with Leverate as my platform. We have Irmaya from Leverate. Okay, I need to disclose that I'm using you. I need to do MT4, MT5. Now everybody knows that meta quotes stop. Probably very soon this MT4, we have now the last build. We need to declare everything, okay? And also your partnerships or your IB. So everything is now should be very transparent. It's not a bad thing. We just need to know that and we know how to prepare and what to do. So, and there's new rules that regarding all this complaint procedures. It's, for me, very similar to what happened in the past in New Zealand. Because in New Zealand, it was, again, a very national sport, let's say 7 or 8 years ago. Everybody used the same office address in New Zealand to open a brokerage in New Zealand, all with the same address, virtual address. You could just register yourself under a very, let's say, cost-effective, I won't call it regulation. To call it regulation is even to make it even more than what it is. But it was very popular. And then it stopped because of lots of complaints, etc. So let's hope that in Australia it won't follow soon. So what happens is that actually many of the regulator, the brokers regulated in Australia, catering for non-Australian clients, okay, or catering mainly for non-Australian clients, are now leaving. We call it the exodus of the ASIC brokers, and they all leave to offshore jurisdiction. It does not mean necessary that they denounce fully the jewel in their crown, this ASIC license. They still leave it in the group. However, they go to offshore jurisdiction as well. And it's very similar to what happened, let's say, in the UK with the FCA regulation and Cyprus with the CISIC regulation. You have this regulation, but then you're starting to see other options as well. So let's discuss some of the places that people are moving to. So Vanuatu probably is one of the most popular options. We have over 10 brokers based in Australia or previously registered in ASIC who went to Vanuatu because probably that's the most cost-effective place. And the problem with that place is that it's still listed or blacklisted in several FATF task forces together with Iran and Syria and other, you know, very exotic places. So not all of the banks accept Vanuatu as a place if you want to bank. Some of our partners do accept it, and that's why I think it still has a good advantage, because it's still, you get a financial license quite cheap. We're here in a crypto-related conference, so we need to understand, if we go on Vanuatu, it's very important not to put inside the business plan crypto. They don't like it. They don't like crypto, they don't like blockchain. You cannot even mention this B word, okay? Do not mention, it's very, very, and they don't explain you why, but it will be rejected. But if you do other common commodities, etc., it works. Bahamas also very, very popular, but Bahamas has $300,000 capital requirement. Belize have $500,000. Belize now have some kind of issue to issue. Seychelles have been very popular 5 or 6 years ago as marketing companies. Lots of affiliate marketers use Seychelles, but then some Ukraine guys did some bribery scandals with Seychelles companies, and then Seychelles started to be very blacklisted on the international banking scene. So now Seychelles, I'm not recommending it for anything, except if you want to be licensed as a mutual fund or an online dealer or a stock exchange. In Seychelles, you can actually be a stock exchange. There are private stock exchanges like TropX. It's like a private stock exchange. You can be regulated in Seychelles. Belize, as I said, was once very popular also for binary options. We had Bank the Binary, which is probably, if people know what is binary options, like a few years ago, Bank the Binary probably was the number one name, brand name on the binary options. I can say good or bad, I'm not being a judge here, but they were regulated in Belize, okay? And of course, you know, if people are working legit, that's good, and you can white and black and everything. BVI, AvaTrade has been one of the first to be regulated in BVI. Now it's more difficult to be regulated. Cayman, we have here our friend also, you're regulated in Cayman, right? And also you're Australian based in Bangkok, actually. It's nice, Cayman, not very straightforward, the license procedure, and also quite expensive, but quite popular. You know, I can tell you, and over the internet, lots of fraudulent licenses. That's so cool. People invent a regulator, and then they sell licenses. Like I read about the Fiji Island Monetary Authority, something like that, FEMA. And they have a fake website, and then you can buy licenses which are not worth the paper, and then you can be a broker regulated by a monetary authority that does not exist. That's the Fiji Island Monetary Authority, etc. There's also a new thing, you can get a bank license in Comoro Islands, which is somewhere very interesting, but if you can check, most of the banks licensed in Comoro Islands are fraudulent banks, so it's very interesting what's going on. These places are all genuine. Estonia is probably the best place in Europe to be regulated nowadays. Again, there are lots of changes there, but if you want to do a crypto wallet, if you want to do a financials, that's probably one of the most popular places in our firm that we regulate now in Estonia. Now, it's important to understand, Estonia is part of the EU, even though it sounds very Russian or something, or it's like, it's an ex-Soviet Union country, but it is a genuine part of the EU. It's a very advanced stage, advanced state. However, it has advantages and disadvantages. But the good thing, and the interesting thing about Estonia, that even though it's part of the EU, the financial license that we're speaking about is not MiFID, and I will explain. Most of the countries under EU law, if you issue a financial license, it's under MiFID. It's like a directive. So CISEC and BaFin and all the other countries you issue, the most popular is probably in Cyprus, the CISEC license. If you issue this Estonian license, it's not issued by the regulator. It's actually issued by the police. It's issued by the Financial Intelligence Unit. This is like a loophole. So it means that you can get a regulation in Estonia without placing 125,000 euro in a box, or 700,000 euro, etc. So it's interesting. So that's quite a nice solution. Marshall Islands, for me, is still probably the best offshore location. And again, offshore has its benefits and has its disadvantages. And I'm not speaking about Marshall Islands to conceal money or to hide money or to launder money or not to disclose profit, okay? Because in this 2019 year and world, everything is declared, and we have automatically information. But you can use Marshall Island for banking purposes, for securing assets, and etc. So, I think that one of the most hot issues now that people I spoke with them here outside, here also in the networking area, is everybody's concerned now with issues with those high roller Chinese mainline traders. Okay, people come from mainland China. They like to play. They like to invest. And now people do not, you know, we have issues here. And I don't know exactly what is the reason for those issues. It can be political issues, it can be other issues, but there is one bottom line. There are issues with those traders. Even if you go and you want to be licensed in Hong Kong if you want to be licensed in Hong Kong and attract mainland traders, you have issues here. If you want to be in Australia, regulated by ASIC and get clients from Shanghai, you have a problem. And this Chinese, mainland China, this influence of Beijing all around the world is very, very, very prominent. And you can open the news every day, another broker is leaving, you know, and leaving and say no business in OC. Our OC business does not accept mainland clients. So that's very interesting and very important to understand. Also in Vanuatu, when Vanuatu became now a popular destination to migrate to, they said, okay, we're not anymore a piece of paper. That's fine. We are also regulating ourselves, which is also, it's a good idea because, as I say, when the industry regulates itself on a proper way, we have less cowboys, we have a good industry for all together. So at the end of the day, even in Vanuatu now, you cannot have a guy only on paper. You need to have people there for at least half a year. So there are new changes also in Vanuatu. We were interviewed for finance magnates regarding that, and it's causing quite a stir, but still it's one of the most favorite places that I recommend, unless if you deal with crypto, offering crypto to the public, Vanuatu. So the other issues that are now affecting the industry, which are related to MasterCard and to other, also UnionPay and also Visa, etc. You need to get now legal opinions for specific businesses. So for financial institutions, for businesses disbursing their own funds, etc., licensed money transmitters, all of this, in the past, you could overcome the requirement to issue legal opinions if you just work. From March 2019, you need to supply reasoned legal opinions. Merchants dealing with CFDs, FX, gaming, crypto need to show a legal opinion. I can show you in a moment how it looks like. What does it mean? This means that all these merchants need to bring reasoned legal opinion, and this is not a general, I cannot, let's say, take a notary from Comoro Island signing, to whom it may concern, this crypto operated by Mr. Jaguar is 100% legal. You cannot do that anymore, okay? You cannot do that anymore because you get fines. So what actually you need? You need to have evidence that you are legally authorized to perform your activities. You need to show a reasoned legal opinion. Okay, I will show you how it looks like. And you need to show, and that's the more, let's say, tricky part. You need to show a certification of effective controls from a qualified independent third parties that the merchant have effective controls, including age and location verification, etc. Now that's funny because, you know, I was 1 month ago in another event in IFX Expo in Cyprus. Alisa was there and many people here also were there also, and I can tell you also Maya with her team. And there was lots of wire solutions company and crypto companies. And when I went and asked them, listen, what is your trick? What is your advantage? Can I bring you to my clients? I said, listen, we have the newest thing. We don't have KYC. No need for KYC. And that's the positive thing. That's the selling point of that company. No KYC is needed. So you need to understand. And it was there on a stage, on a booth inside a very mainstream conference, one of the most popular conferences, actually. When I wanted the business card from these guys, it was totally a stage name. Like Steve Martin, John Williams, something, I don't know that. And the guy speaks with you with a heavy Russian accent. And you're sure that no way that this John Williams was born in Belarus or Moscow or wherever he pretends to be. So, and I, again, no, nothing, no offense, but that's what I saw. I think that we'll have a big problem if that will continue. So the implications, actually, we have to be compliant. We have to be compliant. We have to bring these legal opinions. We have to make sure that we work according to the terms and conditions. This KYC, I understand the burden. I understand that KYC can cause, let's say, if you operate a Forex website or a CFD website, and now you need to get your KYC on every transaction or from a minimal amount, I think it can slow the conversion, maybe. But at the end of the day, guys, this, you know, if we're speaking now on the other place, this is not the games that have been 5 or 6 years ago. Now, compliance is the key. Opinions is the key, and everybody is just going and following advice and legal advice and accountancy and tax advice all the time. Now, let's see how it looks like. So this is like a legal opinion from Colombia, okay? So they ask you like a memorandum in order to explain the legal framework to applicable to promotion of financial activities. This is like in Argentina, this is like in Chile, you know, and there's also from Switzerland and from other places. At the end of the day, this recent legal opinion is addressed to the regulator or to the PSP and says, listen, we checked the activity of that company, and that company in its activity of accepting these certain foreign clients are okay. MasterCard now takes this opinion and say, listen, that you have to get it. You have to get it, and if you do not have it, they just blacklist you, they put you in the match database, and I can tell you, I have clients who by accident, because of some chargebacks, are listed. They're directors of companies that because of accidental chargebacks are now listed for years in data, in WorldCheck, in Thomson Reuters compliance, and I send letters, and we send warning letters, and we threatened to litigate against them. At the end of the day, they can do whatever they want. If they think that you are risky, there's no way to get outside of those databases. And that's a very big problem. So our last topic here, actually, and then we'll move to the next presentation, is where to regulate and bank your business after all, after understanding the risk. So let's start with Lithuania, okay? Lithuania, again, sounds very, let's say, Russian. In there are lots of Jewish heritage in Lithuania. We call it Lita in the Jewish heritage. But Lithuania is also, again, in the tiny state in the Baltics, up there near Estonia and Lithuania. My favorite thing about Lithuania is actually everybody, almost, hopefully, in this stage, I believe, can open a bank in Lithuania. But it's not like Comoros Island, okay? It's a real bank. It's a real, genuine EMI license. And I will explain. In Lithuania, you can have an EMI license. It's like an e-money transmitting license. It's a money license, let's say. Let's say it's one level less than a bank. It's not a forex brokerage. It's not a boiler room. It's a real place where you can get your own SWIFT. I can tell you, in the last years, we issued licenses for 4 of our clients. Some of them do definitely different things than banking, but they say, listen, it's only 150,000 euro plus expenses, so let's open our own bank. And actually, you get your own SWIFT, like if Alisa wants to open her own bank, okay, and want to call it like Krypton Bank, so you take KRPN, and then you have like 4 letters, and that's the SWIFT. And just you need to do agreements, okay? If Iran wants to do its Ledger Tech Bank, you can do it, you know, together, a great bank. You will be the correspondent bank from Switzerland, okay? It's very, very easy. Now, the problem with these banks in Lithuania, you need to be totally covered. It means that you cannot lend money, you cannot borrow money, but if you want clients to get wiring all around the world, you can do and issue your own bank in Lithuania. And it's called EMI, and that's very popular at our firm. We do it, and it's quite successful. And at the end of the day, people can give it to their clients. Malta, it's Malta with an A, but if you speak with the Maltese people, they always call it Malta. That's the way they say their country. So Malta is still, I believe, one of the most popular destinations in Europe for online gambling. Okay, and it's not only a place to regulate, but it's also a very nice ecosystem. And if you go there to places like St. Gillian's, to Valletta, to Sliema, to the Sigma Conference, you can see, I believe it's just amazing what gaming did to the economy of Malta. And it's nice to see also the shifting of the key personnel, because one of my best friends in Malta, okay, Dr. Joe Kushkeri, he was the regulator of the gaming authority, and he moved recently to be the regulator of the financial services authority. So look at the shifting of the personnel. He's still the regulator, but from gambling moved to regulate. And now he's trying to do the same good things that he did in finance. Now he's doing in gaming, he's doing now in finance. And the new laws related to virtual assets, etc., in Malta. It's still in the beginning, but I really recommend Malta. And again, it's part of the EU, and again, the first country in the EU to regulate online gambling. Marshall Island, I spoke about, Vanuatu, I spoke about, Estonia, again, Bahamas, worth mentioning, because apart from Vanuatu, probably that's my, or not even my, most of the people who are doing now offshore licenses nowadays go on Bahamas. There is quite a close link between Belize and Bahamas. People are working there, also working there, but at the end of the day, it's a nice regulation. It's, again, it's an offshore regulation, and many people who are trying to attract not only Asian, but not only Chinese, but also Malaysian, Indonesian, Vietnam, high rollers from Vietnam, or traders from Vietnam, use the Bahamas licenses, and that's good. And the last bit is actually, you cannot regulate, place, or incorporate without good banking system. Okay, I can have a company registered in Comoros Island, and it can be looking very nice on paper. Or, one of my most favorite places, in Cambodia, okay? We were there, in Hong Kong, in IFX Expo also, and we saw the guys from Cambodia, from the Cambodia Derivative Exchange. They had like a big booth, like 20 people. And then like, so 20 people, 10 people working for the regulator and 10 people just pretending to speak with the regulator. It was very interesting to see how they did it. But at the end of the day, I'm not sure how many licenses are there in the Cambodia, but at the end of the day, the problem is when I spoke with them, guys, where can I bank companies or online dealers bank, you know, registered in Cambodia, and imagine what they said, only Cambodia. So that's a problem, because I would not rely on using a bank account in Marshall Island for banking a Marshall Island company, and you see what I mean. So probably the places that I recommend is OCBC Bank in Singapore, not all branches. Like there are specific branches that we work with in OCBC, and they're really good with accepting financial companies. DBS, the same. Also UBS in Singapore, but only for companies from a certain level. ICIC Bank, I don't know if people know that bank. If you get into that website, it looks like a McDonald's website. It looks like, I know, so flashy and colorful and very Indian colors. By the way, I like Indian food and like that. So it's an Indian bank. It's also, I don't know, this sounds catchy name, Ikiki, I don't know how they say it. Yeah, that's the last one. So this one, they have a branch in Hong Kong, which is also good for financial services. Also cheap transfer and like credit cards, really good. Deutsche Handelsbank, that's a good name because people confuse it with Deutsche Bank. So it's not Deutsche Bank. It's not one of the largest banks in the world, but it's a smaller bank in Germany, but we recommend it. Also Westpac in Australia can also bank some of those if you have a mainland company in Australia. So that's how to bank. That's me. We can have a few questions if we have, and if not, you can catch me. I'm here until Saturday. Any questions, guys? Questions? No questions. No problem. No problem. Guys, thank you so much. We have Alyssa. Thank you so much.